One last thank you before we do our final piece. One of the reasons I wanted to do this concert, I've been fortunate enough to be here 10 years now. I work in so many high schools, working with the teachers in these schools. Many of the teachers in these choirs are my former students. Others are alums of our program. But you understand, this level of talent, this exquisite choir that really got together for the first time yesterday, every single one of these kids is in school in the greater Portland metro area. Every one of them is in choir. And there are other grade schools that weren't going to participate in this too. The level of choral singing in this area is extraordinary. And it is because of the commitment of those high school teachers and our school systems to music education. And I hope you can really take that out there and see the results of that. The results of all of these people understanding how much beauty can be created when people choose to work together. That is the basic essence of choir. It doesn't matter where you come from. All of us have a voice. And when we do this together, we can create beauty. Can we thank all of those educators who are at the one of the hardest things, but also one of the most joyous things about teaching choir, teaching music ensemble. If you're an English teacher, you actually can and sometimes are forced to teach the same books every single year in your class. But it winds up being the same thing year after year. But in choir, we need to teach new music every year. Choir instructors, band instructors, orchestra instructors, we need a new textbook every single year. And it puts a lot of strain, but that's also where the joy comes from, and from not being repetitive. We are nothing without the right books, without the right music, without everybody, really. So thank you for everything you've done to me.
Yes, I'm thankful and grateful to be amongst the living composers. This last piece that we'll do for you back in the year 2000 was contacted by a woman in Austin, Texas. She wanted to know what I'd been willing to write a commission piece in memory of both her parents, who had just recently died. After more than 50 years of marriage, and just weeks apart, she thought that their mother had really died of a broken heart. And they wanted me to set to music the family's favorite poem, Stopping by Woods of a Snowy Evening by Robert Frost. Maybe some of you know it, you get to the lines, and miles to go before I sleep, and miles to go before I sleep. And I asked her if I could think about it. She said, sure, so I hung up the phone, and I really did think about it. Spent some days thinking, and I had two concerns. One was that I didn't know if I would be able to write music that could possibly do justice to these two people who obviously lived such a beautiful, rich life, and created this family and this bond. And also, I didn't know if Robert Frost's poetry needed me mucking around with it. You know, some poems are just fine as they are. But I memorized the poem, I lived with it, and I don't know, a few days later, just some musical ideas kind of bubbled to the surface, and I really took my time, several months writing this, just a 5-minute piece. And when it was finished, I flew down to Austin, and we premiered the piece for the family, and I think there was some sense of catharsis for them. I know there was for me. And afterwards, it was well received. We thought, okay, let's try to publish this. So we contacted the Robert Frost Estate and said, we just need your permission so we can go ahead and publish the sheet music. And they wrote back and said, no. And so I wrote this impassioned letter saying, I don't think you understand, I've worked a long time on this. And all we're trying to do is just glorify his poetry and possibly even introduce it to an entire new generation of people who hadn't heard it. And they wrote back and said, no. And if we find out that it's been publicly, we will sue you and the choir. You're free to use it when it becomes public domain in the year 2038. So I thought I had another one of these Trump songs, like the CLL library, I put my trunk in it. Sometime in the distant future, I pull this thing out, dust it off, and see if it still worked. And then I got this idea. I called up Charles Anthony Sylvester, the same poet, Tony, who wrote the piece for Sick Fail about his wife, who wrote the Leonardo da Vinci Slime Machine. And I said, okay, Tony, I need a poem with the exact metrical structure as the Robert Frost. And there's all these places in the music where I'm musically painted his words and his ideas. I need you to find words that make sense in those places. And then it ends on this meditation with sleep over and over and over. And that cannot change. Go. So this was like Friday night at 8 o'clock. And he calls me Saturday morning by 8 o'clock and says, all right, I think I've got it. And what happened, this is actually while Julie was still alive, his 3-year-old just would not go to sleep. And so he wrote the piece then about sleep from a child's perspective. You know, as adults, sometimes we forget that sleep is a big deal to kids. You know, first you've got the whole ritual, you get into bed and your toe is sticking out a little too far, then a monster can get that right, and that's here, and you drink water. But then there's this idea that, okay, so let me just get this straight, I'm going to close my eyes and everything's going to go away. My mind's going to play all kinds of movies, and then when I wake up in 8 to 10 hours, this will all be here again. It's a big, kind of scary, awe-inspiring thing for a child. And his poetry had that kind of lightness and innocence and effervescence, and it gave my music this depth that it didn't have before. And now I can categorically say that I like Tony's poem much better than that stupid Robert Frost poem. Before we perform that for you, I would be remiss if I didn't just have my own quick thanks here, and that is to Dr. Nathan Sperry, who has become a fast friend. And what you see here in this auditorium, which is extraordinary, truly extraordinary, is just 10 years. You've been here for 10 years, is that right? Yeah. 10 years, can you imagine what the next 10 years will bring, the next 20 for anything? And thanks to all of these incredible musicians, players here on stage, the high school students, all the PSU singers, it's just been a joy and a privilege and an honor to make music with all of them. And more than that, I've gotten to know a bunch of them and meet them. Parents are just raising good people, and that's really a great thing right now. Thank you all so much.